Hello, everybody. Welcome to Duncan and Doonkeen. We are your hosts, myself, Drew Duncan, and her, Time Doonkeen. Do not forget that Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Duncan Doonkeen. Don't forget, you can find us on YouTube, Duncan and Doonkeen, and we are wherever you are listening to podcasts. Tell your device to play Duncan and Doonkeen on iHeart, Spreaker, Google, Spotify. We are wherever you're listening to podcasts. And additionally, you can find myself at Drew Duncan Radio across the board on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And you can find Time Doonkeen across the board on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram as well. Folks, hell of a show to get to. Plenty to discuss. The last UFC Fight Night card, we got that on tap. We have comments from Dana White on tap. Major League Baseball, whether or not that season's going to go forward. It looks like it may. We have that on tap as well. Plenty to get to. Time, how are you doing today?
I'm good. I missed everybody. I missed sport. I missed talking about sports this week. We have a lot to talk about.
We do. We do. And let's kick it off with the last UFC fight. The main event, Blaydes. To me, it was an impressive performance. However, Dana White would beg to differ. As a matter of fact, he said, and I quote, "If you talk that kind of shit, you better perform well." End right. quote. Basically, Dana White alluding to he doesn't think that Blaydes' performance was really all that good. I'm going to keep real. Give me a moment here, okay? Time. I love you, but give me a minute here. Give me time. See what I did there? Look, I'm watching this fight. I know these two fighters fairly well, and I'm thinking to myself, if you want stand and bang, you're not going to get it between these two heavyweights, right? The fight was won on the ground. Sure, Blaydes was running out of gas towards the end of the fight, but he had basically dominated four out of the first five rounds. And it was desperation going into the last round. And I thought Khabib had changed the whole game with how he looked at the ground attack, because beforehand, people would boo all that stuff going on. But then all of a sudden, people start to cheer it. Obviously, there's no fans involved. But to me, the win was dominating. The win was on point. What the hell is Dana White looking at? What's he complaining about?
It was the fact that fight week, going into fight week, Blaydes talked so much trash about not getting paid what he was worth. And if you're looking for a five-round fight, you're not going to find it because he's going to make a rag doll out of his opponent. I mean, he talked cash money the entire fight week. And he threw everybody under the bus. And he did gas in the third round. But if you look at it, he had several takedowns. Lots of takedowns throughout the entire fight.
Exactly. It was his fight. I mean, come on. Let's be honest. He won that fight easily. Right. Granted, it went to the judges, and I understand where you're coming from to a degree. I understand where Dana White is coming from to a degree. But let's be honest. Blaydes is another guy in a long list of people right now who are wanting more money. You and I talked about it last week. You know, there's a UFC 251 fight card right now that's going to feature some fighters that have complained about money, you know, and one of them is a female fighter, and she's already talked about making more money on Instagram and Dancing with the Stars and taking pictures of herself and her husband than, you know, she ever did fighting in MMA. But yet, for some odd reason, Paige VanZant is like, oh yeah, sure, no, I'll take a fight. So let's get to the real here for a moment. And explain and understand, Paige VanZant was complaining long before any of this stuff happened, to a degree. Why in the hell is anybody taking a fight when they're complaining about the type of money that they're not making?
Well, exactly. And is it because they're only making a certain amount on paper? Because as we saw last week, someone came out and said that they got $100,000 of hush money. So if you're Paige VanZant, she's beautiful. She's She's done all types of modeling, Dancing with the Stars. Why would you want to mess your face up if you're not getting paid what you think you're worth? Why wouldn't you just do swimsuit shoots?
Right. So you've agreed to take a fight, knowing that you could basically lose your own investment. Why in the hell is she even taking a fight to begin with? I mean, there's got to be something there. Is it the love of MMA? Is it wanting to compete? Is it the, you know, deep down competitive nature that's inside you? Is it the money? Is it knowing that, you know, this is a good opportunity to make an even bigger name for herself right now? I mean, because, you know, a good majority of people saw her and her husband on Instagram and what was basically nude photos while they're working out and all this kind of stuff. Okay, so you're telling me you make more money doing that than you do actually fighting. What the hell are you fighting for? That's right. The thing to me.
I completely agree. Why would these fighters take fights if they're not getting paid?
Right.
They have to be getting outside sponsorships.
Which Dana White and the UFC allegedly blocked off. Okay. And we all know by now, right, that if you're, you know, getting enough clicks, views, likes, you know, subscribers, followers, whatever you want to call it, you know, social media is going to, you know, they're going to pay you. Right? They're going to pay you. That's what she's talking about. Right. Not alluding to. She's literally saying Instagram pays me more money to take these pictures than Dana White does. So if that's the case, then why in the hell take a fight? There's no reason to.
I'm talking about outside sponsorships with Instagram, with YouTube. I mean, she's probably got sponsorships with all of them for her fights, for appearing.
So you think that by taking this fight, she's increasing her social media following, and that's going to help her make more money in the long run?
Well, she's definitely developing her fan base.
Mm.
And she's making herself more relevant.
Is that what you would want a fighter to do, though, Dan? You know, as a promoter time? Is that what you
No,
would've...
I want someone to be in it for the love of the sport.
Mm. Are we losing that, though? Because, you know, as I said in the introduction, Major League Baseball supposedly getting going, kind of the original deal that they had all the way back in March, which we'll get into here momentarily. But are we losing the love of sport and everybody kind of worried about what's going to happen in their future? And now we're just trying to do everything that we can to line our pockets.
Definitely, definitely. Sports right now is being ruled by greed.
Mm. You know, there are a lot of people that would say it was that way before, right? But, you know, here's my thing. You know, for instance, Dak Prescott supposedly just signed a $31.4 million tender with the Dallas Cowboys. But Tom Brady, into his 40s, and having been to 9 Super Bowls and winning 6 of them, signed a $30 million deal. So why on planet Earth did Dak Prescott think that he was worth any more than that to begin with? I have a hard time with all this. I really do. I mean, you know, the old saying is money talks and BS walks. Or pardon me, money walks and BS talks. Okay, so let's get past the BS here. Okay, what's the real reason you think somebody like Paige VanZant or Blaydes or anybody else is taking a fight to begin with?
Well, I think Blaydes is in it for a different reason. I think Paige VanZant likes the fan base. I think she likes the attention. I think she likes having her hand in lots of different pockets. Or I shouldn't say pockets. I think she likes to have lots of coals in the fire. But Blaydes is after that heavyweight title. And according to him, he's next in line right behind Francis.
Well,
his statement, he sounded very entitled. And I think that's what rubbed Dana White the wrong way.
So, you as a promoter, you hear this and you go, you know, bro, I'm going to need you to do a little bit more. Because obviously, they've already got number 3 with Stipe Miocic and Daniel Cormier, right? That fight's going to happen. Mm-hmm. So that kind of leaves, I guess, John Jones out of the entire woodwork to begin with anyway. All right. So he wants a title shot. All right. So if you're Dana White right now, you're talking to this guy, you're going, all right, dude, here's what I need you to do. What are you going to tell him?
Well, like just like Dana White said, he wants them to get a little more momentum. He wants them to stay active because at this point, the way he looked in this fight, he doesn't look like he's ready for a heavyweight title shot. And I agree with that statement.
Really? After the way he dominated that fight? I mean, let's be honest. He kept dude on the ground for almost all that fight. When they did stand and bang, he didn't do so great. But that's not Daniel right. Cormier's game. That might be Stipe Miocic's game, but that's not Daniel Cormier's. That might be John Jones, but that's not Daniel Cormier's. So let's say Daniel Cormier figures out a way to finally win in that trilogy and come away with the title. Wouldn't Daniel Cormier versus Blaydes make a whole hell of a lot of sense since they're very two similar fighters?
And that looks like a good fight on paper. That's a good fight. They're both wrestlers. Blaydes has the most takedowns in UFC history.
Right.
That fight makes sense.
Right. And then, of course, Cormier is a wrestling champion in mm-hmm. the Olympics. Okay? So that fight...
And from OSU here in Oklahoma.
Exactly. Throw that out there. So, you know, that fight, as you said, it looks good on paper. It's the right thing to do. Mm-hmm. Okay? Now, let's say Stipe figures out a way to make that fight work. He wins again. He's still the champ. Okay, then what? Does Blaydes face the winner of Miocic versus the next guy?
Correct me if I'm wrong, but hasn't Blaydes fought Francis before?
Off the top of my head.
I think twice.
Probably. That feels right. Don't, you know, I mean, come on, it's late at night. Don't quote me on anything right now. You know, I work two other jobs, you know what I mean? So.
So I wouldn't put him up against Francis yet. I mean, I would say that fight, the winner, you know, I like that DC fight. I like the Blaydes and DC fight.
Okay. So again, let's say Miocic wins. What are you going to do next, right? Because you can't have DC, you know, in kind of like in the works. Because, look, we have to get past DC. He, like so many other MMA fighters, has retired 15 freaking times, you know. And him and this John Jones thing, it's so old hat already. Okay, there's no more Brock Lesnar. That's probably never going to happen again in MMA. All right, so.
I hope not.
Right. Yeah, me too, to be honest with you. So Dana White's got to figure out this heavyweight division, which is lackluster, to say the least. Okay. Stipe, look, how much longer can he carry the division? You know? I mean, because that's what he's having to do. Because John Jones wants mm-hmm. more money, right? There's a lot more out-of-control stuff going on with him outside of the octagon. Dana White's trying to figure all this nonsense out. He's in the middle of a pandemic, as we've talked about. He's got rides he's dealing with. 251 is supposed to be the first time that we're going to see the Fight Island. And that's three title fights in a row, right? Just on the main card alone, which is... You know, preceded by who we just talked about, Paige VanZant. I mean, can you feel Dana White just clawing and grabbing for anything at this point?
Well, and he's got fighters that are fighting every 3 weeks now. I mean, if they don't take collateral damage, he'll fight them again within a month.
Right.
That hasn't been done yet before in UFC history. I mean, you fought quarterly at best for UFC.
Well, and maybe that's why guys are truly turning down fights, you know. And mm-hmm. let's be honest, there are some people out there that are in panic mode. Hey, look, man, I'm not going to fight right now. I'm not going to put my family at risk. I'm not going to put my own personal health at risk any more than I already am. Obviously, we get my head kicked in. And then, mm-hmm. of course, there's the other aspect of, dude, I really haven't been able to train adequately That's the other aspect. And then there's the final aspect of the financial situation. I'm not going to get paid what I'm worth for this fight. So why in the hell should I go and risk myself on all levels, win, lose, draw, get sick, get COVID, get my head smashed in, and potentially die in the octagon, which, as you and I both know, it does unfortunately happen. It's the real reality of the sport. Why am I going to go there for X amount of dollars? I mean, look, it's easy to see Dana's side. It's easy to see the fighter's side. I mean, what the hell do you do? It's a catch 22.
Also, and if you look at it, okay, Tim Miller had a he won via armbar at the last UFC card.
Right.
So when they were talking to Tim Miller on his interview, he said, it's a lot different to fight without the fans. And he got emotional and said, I really miss the fans. He nearly cried because he said, I miss the energy of the fans. So it's hard to fight right now without a fan base, without your family and friends there to cheer you on.
Right. Well, and think about it, right? Somebody like a McGregor.
We're in uncharted territories right now.
Exactly. And think about, you know, like I began to make mention of, a McGregor jumping on top of the cage, flipping off haters, people chanting him on as he does his stuff. I mean, you know, you talked about feeding off the energy and being that type of person, you know, that you yourself, you know, you gravitate towards that. And, you know, that's kind of what gives you a little extra oomph when you're, you know, hosting your live events. And, you know, there are a lot of fighters that do that. You know, and I think that all this stuff that we've heard over the years, right, about, well, the crowd noise doesn't affect me, and you blur it out, and you block it out, and all that, we're starting to see that that's a bunch of nonsense. You know, and we all kind of knew that deep down, but now I think we're starting to figure out that a lot of people really need that crowd. Because whether it's negative towards them or positive towards them, they feed off of that one way or the other, and it gives them a little something extra as they head into that situation of competing.
Right. And a month ago, when we first started having crowdless UFC fights, there were a lot of people that said, I enjoyed not being able to focus in on my corners and my coach. A lot of people said that. And now we're a month in, I think the realization has set in. And I think that people really miss the fans.
And, you know, I think that's a great lead into the next thing. Time Max gives up on the stool. He's saying he doesn't have it. You know, his coach, Drysdale, said that he would do that again and again and again. And there was a moment of pause, by the way, when he's going, do you really want to lose? And he says, yes. And he paused, and he's breathing heavy. His coach is at that point. And he's like, no, man, you can do this. Okay, time. So there's been a lot of criticism for Max's corner about what should have been done. Okay, the fight wasn't too egregious from what I saw. I didn't think that I think he was losing. Yes.
Yeah, he was losing.
Right. Did I think he could have pulled through if he wanted to? Yes.
He could have gone through to the end and probably gotten a decision, and he would have lost.
Right.
However, who wants to take that collateral damage on a fight that you were offered with 2 weeks' notice?
But here's the antithesis, though, right? You fight to prove something, right? You fight to prove that you got more heart than the person in front of you. You fight to prove that you're tougher than the person in front of you. You fight to prove that you're, quote, the baddest man on the planet, right? That's why a BMF belt was created anyways. Hopefully it wasn't just out of sheer publicity by Dana White. Right,
it definitely was.
Potentially,
it definitely was.
I'm not going to agree or disagree. I'm just going to say potentially. All right, you fight to get out of your situation. You and I both know a lot of fighters come from slums. They come from, you know, difficult situations in life. They have something to prove. Okay, so you're in there. It's you, the person against, you know, that's in front of you, and that's it. Quote, I don't have it. You hear those words. Do you say, okay, bro, we're not going to fight anymore?
Right.
Do you?
Yeah, that's what I would say. I would say, All right, call it. I think fighters have a 4 and a 5 year longevity in the fight game. I think you want it so bad in the beginning. Once you make it, the spark fizzles out. So once you no longer yearn for that win, once you feel that you've got nothing left to prove to yourself, why take the collateral damage? He shouldn't have quit during a fight. But he also, why take the collateral damage if he's already losing? He wasn't given the fair shake to have a full fight camp.
Okay, but come on. I mean, you and I both know that fighters take fights on short notice all the time. Like Conor McGregor and Nate Diaz, right? You know, McGregor was scheduled to fight somebody else. The fight fell through. McGregor decided to fight Nate Diaz. He loses that fight, but then what does he do later on? He comes back after a full camp, gets the victory over Nate Diaz in a decision where two guys just literally beat the hell out of each other. There wasn't a whole lot of takedowns in that, right? And even when there was, it was, look, man, stand back up. You and I are going to do this, okay? Do you think Max maybe one day is going to look back on that and go, you know, I should have at least finished?
Yeah, I think it'll be a regret. But I also think that you're talking about two different styles of fighters. I think you're talking about Nate Diaz and Conor McGregor. Those types of athletes live to fight and fight to live. And other fighters fight for the prestige, fight for the notoriety. And once they've made it, they've got nothing left to prove.
So you're saying Max was in that situation?
I believe so.
Yeah, this is a thing that I have asked several fighters about and that I've talked about really since about 2016 or 17, and that is MMA becoming a fad. Has it gone to that level already? You know, because remember back in the 80s, everybody wanted to be a boxer or a pro football player, right? Now that transition is happening to where we're seeing more and more young adults go, you know, I think I really want to be an MMA fighter. Right? Is it becoming a fad once people figure out getting your head kicked in and all that damn glamorous?
Yeah, it's becoming a fad. But I think the gold wears off real quick. Especially when you get punched in the face.
Did Max fall victim to that?
I just think that he lost his will to want to fight.
Okay. What does he have to do to get
it
back?
And I'm sure he'll regret it.
Of course he will. Come on. Look, 10 years from now, because let's say his career ends up being, let's be honest, a dumpster fire, he may look back on this and go, that was my definitive moment. Because look at Chech Congo. Remember his comeback, right? A lot of people thought that fight should have been stopped, and it wasn't, and he ended up being the one delivering the knockout, right? Now, since then, Congo's career took a little bit of a dive, obviously, but the point of what I'm saying is, in that moment, he defined his own self. And isn't that all that matters in sport and especially in MMA to begin with? I mean, come on, we're always talking about it's you and the guy in front of you, so you know, who's got the will to win, right? We talk about that in football. Who wanted that ball more when it was thrown up in the air? Who wanted that win more? Who wanted it more when the running back was making that carry and three different guys were trying to shoot the ball from him and he was able to get away from that? We talk about it in basketball in one-on-one situations. Look, one guy just really wanted that a little bit more. That was played about as good as you could by X defender, but X offensive player clearly showed that he wanted it more, vice versa. I mean, come on. I mean, can't Max look maybe back on that one day and go, you know, that really defined who I am as a fighter.
Well, yeah, and then he'll make amends and say that he's no longer a fighter. Like I said, that 4 or 5 year sweet spot where your fight career is at its peak, and then after that, once you lose the will to fight, you don't get it back. Mm. I mean, he may take a small fight 10 years from now for a low-budget organization in his hometown, or come back as a guest. But it will be forever be a stain on his reputation. You can't come back from that.
No, you can't.
He'll never have another UFC fight.
Maybe.
No, he'll never have another UFC fight. You don't re-sign someone that quit in between rounds.
Wow. Well, I will take your word for that one, and I'm not going to disagree. You know, I mean, I'm not. You know, look.
Let's go ahead and make a friendly wager.
Okay. No, I'm down for that. Okay. You say Max will never be in the UFC ever again. I'm going to give him an 80% shot of he gets at least an amateur fight in the UFC, right? Or prelim. Regardless, because prelims can be pro too. You and I both know that. So I'll say he at least gets a prelim fight. You say never going to happen.
Never. Right? I say never.
Okay. So what's the gap here? 6 months? A year? What do you think?
2 years.
2 years? Wow. I will hella take that bet. Whoa. I'm down for that. All right, there you go. So we have that friendly wager. All right, so let's get into this. Major League Baseball, I'm going to read some things really quick here from you. This is directly from ESPN in an article that was written about the MLB. Quote, Major League Baseball plans to hold a 60-game season that begins around July 24, but first needs players to sign off on a health and safety protocol and pledge to arrive at home stadiums by July 1 to prepare for the season, sources familiar with the situation told ESPN. The article goes on, the league's owners voted to implement a 60-game season Monday, hours after the MLB Players Association rejected a 60-game proposal that would have included an expanded postseason and other salary bumps. And it continues again, after nearly 3 months of fruitless negotiations, MLB opted to use the right given to it in the party's March 26 agreement to impose a schedule of its desired length. By choosing a season of 60 games, the league will pack in about as many games as it can through September 27, the league's self-imposed cutoff for the regular season to end. All right, so time. Major League Baseball, by the way, the vote was 33-5 for this. What do you think? Are we going to see the MLB begin on July 24 or no?
Well, I think we won't know until July 1st, whenever people report to their camps and they start taking the COVID testing. And I think that we'll have some people pop up for COVID. And then we'll have our definite answer if it's going to continue. I think it'll be contingent upon testing.
Yeah.
I'm still 70% hesitant that there's going to be an MLB season of any magnitude, including 60 games.
I got to tell you, in a lot of ways, I'm right there with you. And for me, the conundrum is simply this. How is it that college football, most programs have said, look, we're suspending everything. The NFL put out a press release not too long ago, a couple days ago. They said, look, we advise, not telling you not to do so, but we advise heavily against voluntary workouts until training camp starts for the safety of everybody that's involved, because Clemson's had a lot of players, over 25, as a matter of fact, pop up with, you know, coronavirus. The University of Houston has had it. Then, of course, into the professional level, we've seen the Dallas Cowboys, the Houston Texans. I mean, at what point do we just throw our hands up and just go, look, outside of maybe MMA or even boxing, there's just not going to be any damn sports this year?
We're nearly to that point. We're almost there. In fact, the Patriots came out this week, and they said, for all of our 2020 season ticket holders, if you feel that you have a compromised immune system and you aren't going to utilize your tickets, come back at 2021, and we'll honor your season tickets. And I think that spoke magnitude.
I do, too. I saw that same thing. And I thought, you know, that kind of tells us where we're all at. You know, and John Harbaugh, you know, the head coach of the Baltimore Ravens, said that he's basically preparing for, you know, all scenarios possible involved. He's, you know, that, you know, you can look at it either way you want to, whether it's this or that and a third. And I'm just thinking to myself, you know, I played football. And in the game of football, to a lot of people, they go, it's getting towards the end of June, you're still fine. To an NFL head coach, you're going, damn, dude, I'm coming up on July, and I've had no time with my football players. We're not watching film. We're not doing voluntary workouts. We don't know if we're going to have a training camp. Who the hell knows if I'm going to have a preseason? Right now, they're looking at two games. There may end up being no games. I've got to have practice through, you know, this day and this day and that day. I'm not allowed to go to another team's facility and practice, even if I do when I travel on the road. So I've got to cram everything that I can basically inside of 2 days, you know, and that includes walkthroughs, drills, film study, you know, seven drill, you know, I mean, come on, contact, all that stuff. Yeah, I can't have practices with another team. It's all to a point now where at this juncture, if you're a coach, you are preparing for, basically, I'm going to have to get a team ready for football on week one of the regular season, which, by the way, has expanded now. So what the hell? Yeah, if I'm a football coach, I am losing my ever-living mind because I'm thinking to myself, there is no way in hell that I'm going to be able to properly prepare my team to get ready for war. And if I'm a baseball coach, I'm thinking to myself, okay, guys are supposed to report July the 1st, 2 week incubation period. So that means they're going to all get tested. So 14 days are going to go by. That's July 15. So I've got 9 days till July 24 to start getting my guys ready for a 60 game season and then the playoffs and a pennant race. Like, seriously? How in the hell?
It will be survival of the fittest, and the elitist athletes are going to shine through.
You know, I don't know about elite athletes. I think it's going to be the most determined, you know, because we've seen some select athletes.
Isn't that the same thing?
To a degree, yes, but you and I both know that what separates good from great is work ethic. And we've seen some guys that are filming themselves and putting it out there. I'm still putting in the work. Meanwhile, how many other guys are sitting around getting fat going, I don't think there's going to be sports. I'm okay. Think about that. So, again, that's where we're going to find the separation, the work ethic. You know, you think about anything. You know, there are a lot of mediocre guys right now in the NFL. There are a lot of mediocre guys in the NBA. There are plenty of people that many believe would outshine anybody at any level. But the difference is work ethic and capability and coachability and all those things that go into being on a team. Right? So you've got one guy that's not the best in the world, but he's at practice an hour early, he leaves an hour late, he's doing film study after everybody else, he spends an extra 45 minutes to an hour and a half in the weight room. You and I both know who the hell we really want on our football team. Is he as good as somebody who spends half as much time doing the other thing because he's got natural ability? No, he's not. But I know all these aforementioned things that I talked about, work ethic, coachability, and the promise to be there when I need him. I think it was former football coach of the Oakland Raiders that said availability is the best ability. So we start thinking about that. I mean, look at Eli Manning. How many games in a row did he play for the New York Giants until he was benched. He was about to break all the records. Right? Look at Brett Favre. Mm-hmm. Doesn't matter. That guy, broken thumb, broken finger. I don't give a damn, dude. Broken leg, whatever. I'm out there for my team on Sunday. That's what matters. You and I both know that. So when you start thinking about that, it's not necessarily who's the best athlete. Because Lamar Jackson is one hell of an athlete, and I think he's a better quarterback than people give him credit for in terms of his throwing capability, but does he have the work ethic to keep himself at that level? Think about Tom Brady. He said, I'll retire when I hate the preparation. The preparation is what matters the most, and the ones who are willing to prepare without a coach having to stand over the top of them and say, you have to do this, those, to me, are going to be the ones who win.
Absolutely.
Oh, time. I thought for sure you had a better comeback than that. You disappointed me so bad. I know. I could be really convincing by accident. Okay, so bottom line.
I think work ethic is going to shine through in this season. I think the people that stayed active, the people that worked on their cardio, that stayed active during this whole COVID season, that's going to shine through. And then I think that we're going to see a whole rash of mediocre players. It's going to be a hard season to watch.
Man, it's going to be tough. I think it's going to be a lot like
it's
watching.
It's going to be hard to watch.
It could be like watching, the All-American Football Conference or whatever the hell that thing was called. I mean, it could be along those levels. Kind of on a lighter note here, really quick, Tua admitted that one of his guilty pleasures is listening to Shania Twain. He eventually called Shania Twain out in the interview and said, hey, you're kind of my crush. Maybe you can DM me back now. Let's see what happens. Shania Twain reposted and said, why does it have to be a guilty pleasure? But she never did say whether or not she was interested in the rookie quarterback. If you're Shania Twain, if you're not taken, are you going after the Dolphins pick a quarterback, or are you kind of like, I appreciate it, bro, but no thanks. You know what I mean?
Is she married?
I don't know enough about Shania Twain to know any damn thing about her, to be honest with you, other than she's Shania
I'm
Twain.
I'm going to be honest, back in the day, she was my crush, too, but I haven't seen her in 2020, so I don't know if she's still my current crush.
You had a crush on Shania Twain?
Oh, my God. She was beautiful.
Really?
I would dance around and sing any maid of mine all day.
I guess you'll learn more stuff about people, huh? I don't know.
She was hot in some Rockies. Don't play.
I mean, she's not... I'll just say she's not my type.
I'm a country girl, so she's my type.
I'm not saying she's not pretty. I'm just saying, I recognize her beauty, but, would I try to holler at her? Probably not, keeping it real,
I would have tried to holler at her in 2008. Okay, so did you see that the NBA put out a 145-page guideline for this COVID?
Yes.
Guidelines that they have to implement. And on top of that, they also have a whistleblower hotline.
Yeah.
And I've heard people joking that it's the Chris Paul hotline.
Oh, yeah. It's impossible, the standard that they've set. There's literally no way in hell. And with the number spiking in Florida, what was it, 4,000 cases that popped up? There's no way in hell. How are you going to have these games in Orlando? Guys can't practice. Guys can't do this. Guys can't do that. You've got to wash everything down and in the gym one at a damn time. That's not how sports works. Not with basketball, not with football, not with baseball, and not with lacrosse, not with soccer. It's not the way that it happens. You need the practice with your team for a reason. And if this is, come on. If this is what Adam Silver thinks is going to happen and it's going to work out, that dude is preparing for the NBA to look like the G League. Seriously. There's no point at this juncture. Okay, not only are they talking about eight meaningless games, all right, one's a play-in on the West and on the East. All right, oh, whoop-de-doo, right? So somebody's not going to give a damn. Somebody else is going to give a damn. We're going to get horrible games.
Yeah, and why are they continuing the playoffs? Why not just call it and try to start over for next season?
Because money...
You know what? 2020 was a bust.
Yeah.
Let's just keep it pushing.
It is a bust. All the way around. Look, there's no way in hell. No way in hell.
Well,
go ahead.
And the eight teams that made the playoffs are not still the eight teams that are going to play in the playoffs. It's not the same. It's not the same team.
Right.
It's the same athletes. I would just call this season and start over.
Yeah, no, I think everybody needs to give up. I really do. I don't know how Dana White's doing it. This guy deserves so much more credit than he is getting right now. You know, I mean, he really does deserve so much more credit.
At this point, he's carrying America's sports.
Yeah, I agree. You know, and the hate that he's getting is really unwarranted. It really is.
He's really getting hate from the fighters. It's only from the fighters, the fans that follow UFC, appreciate his effort.
You know, I guess we'll see whether or not they continue to figure out a way to make this thing happen. But, you know, for me, the bottom line is I think we all need to be grateful to Dana White, because if it wasn't for him, mm-hmm. we'd have jack squat to talk about right now. And, you know, the MLB is not interesting except for this. You know, there are people saying that this is the most, you know, media that Bubba Wallace has got throughout all this whole thing. Well, I think they have it wrong, because number one, that's a stupid ass statement to make. But this is the most media that NASCAR has got, and I don't know how long, because their brand has been tanking for the last 3 or 4 years. That playoff thing that mm-hmm. they implemented has not worked for anything. The NBA... with their rigid expectations, you know, college football and NFL right now, as we previously discussed, well, their players getting, you know, the COVID and Corona and quarantining and all this stuff and waiting more results. And some people have already tested positive. It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. And if it does, it's going to look like a complete shit show. Just to be honest with you,
yeah.
And nobody wants to watch mediocre, professional, or even college sports. We want to see what we're used to, and that is a high level of play, because that's the expectancy. So why are we willing to put out a mediocre product? Well, because we need our sponsors from Coke to carry the weight? I'm done with that. You know, your money that you've been greedy for the last couple of years, and you want more and more and more and more and more and more. Well, guess what, big bro? It is coming to fruition. It's all coming to a halt. It's all coming to a head, however you want to say it. You're getting effed. You don't like it, but you don't like it when the players get effed. So here's a dose of your own medicine, Mr. Owner, Mr. GM, Mr. Whomever. It is now you getting a dose of what you had coming to you. And that is why I respect Dana White right now, because even though he did cut off the fighters years ago from making their own money, which I still think is a travesty, at least at this juncture, he's able to say, I am putting on professional fights at the highest level and my people are getting paid. Period.
Yeah. And all these athletes that come back, the basketball players, the football players, baseball players, they're going to come back, they're going to be out of shape, they're going to be, their cardio is going to be crap. But don't you think these high-level athletes that get paid millions of dollars per year should be held to a higher standard than everyone during COVID season they should stay ready? Don't you think that they owe America that much to stay ready?
Well,
we should get paid $6 million a year.
I think they owe it to themselves. If you want to keep making that kind of money, you have to be ready to make that kind of money. We've talked about this before. You are paid what you're worth. You know, and we've seen this before. Mm-hmm. I think it was Albert Hainsworth, you know, with Washington. You know, that whole situation with him and Mike Shanahan. Dude, you came in 20 pounds overweight. You're not going to play until you're physically ready to play at the position of down lineman in the NFL on defense when you're getting your head cracked. You're putting yourself in a bad situation. My job as a coach is to protect you. If I don't think you can go, you're not going to go. If I think you're ready, I'm going to put you out there. Period. And it's crazy because Mike Shanahan was basically the one who let RG3 run his knee into the ground. So who the hell knows? I know this much. I'm over a lot of the conversation on the what ifs, and I think we need to start maybe seeing reality and just kind of wait it all out. And I think that Dana White needs to start getting more praise than hate because he's keeping people employed, he's keeping fans involved, and he's giving us all something to watch. And he even said, I'm putting on fight cards every weekend from now until the next 10 years. And how many people can say, I know for sure that I'm putting on sports from now into the next 10 years? Nobody can. But Dana White's boldly made that statement, and he stuck by it. And we're having fight cards, whether they're good or bad, we're having them. Period. Time, anything else you want to go with here real quick?
Nope. As soon as you know about the basketball football season, we'll let you know. I need something for it. We don't know. Nobody knows. We'll just see how this tournament thing plays out.
I concur. All right, everybody. She is Time Doonkeen. I am Drew Duncan. You were listening to Duncan and Doonkeen. We are wherever you are listening to the podcast. Tell your device to play Duncan and Doonkeen on Spreaker, iHeart, Spotify, Google, Apple. We are wherever you are listening to the podcast. You can follow Duncan and Doonkeen on social media. That's at Duncan Doonkeen on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram across the board. And do not forget that you can follow us individually. Myself, I am at Drew Duncan Radio, and she is at Time Doonkeen. And as always, don't you dare touch that dial.